did not know that.
I didn't know either. There's a lot of stuff I learned.
You learn a lot of crap.
Down at zoning meeting.
Like to call the order of the North Canaan Planning and Zoning Commission. You all set? Okay. Like to call the order of the North Canaan Planning and Zoning Commission, October 14th, 2014, at the Town Hall, 100 P Street, at 7 p.m. At the time, we'll open the regular meeting, determine the need for alternates. We need alternates. We have none to seat this evening. We have Pete Brown and Vice Chairman Dan Adam and Chairman Steve Allen. That would determine our quorum. We also have in attendance our zoning enforcement officer and our recording secretary, Ersley Odell. This time, I would entertain public comment, so anyone in any one of these empty chairs at any given time can speak up. It's pretty vacant in here tonight. Well, we'll move right into, I have public comment in two areas on here, so we'll move into the zoning officer's report and issues. I have a question for you regarding the trailers up behind Barracks Road, if anything.
No, I plan on sending a letter that they are not permitted to operate a campground up there. I have forgotten to leave a note for Cheryl to get me the cars on it, so
right.
I get the names of the owners and things, but
okay.
Definitely I will be sending a letter in regards to the complaints about the usage of trailers and that it's not a permitted, you know, campground, and I'll cite that there are regulations both local and state for campgrounds, because I have an expert here.
Just for the record, I originally brought this to Ruth's attention. I was at a customer of mine's facility and witnessed at the time four trailers on this one location with someone apparently heading towards the wood line with a pail of something that they didn't want and dumping it into the woods. So I was a little alarmed at what I saw, so I brought it to Ruth's attention. Also, Vice Chairman Dan Adam was at the same location sometime later looking to purchase a Jeep part from the same individual and witnessed the trailers also and was concerned about the public safety of the people living in those trailers. And that's part of our concerns is planning and zoning. And what else do you have for us this evening, Ruth?
We also had a request come in for a final sign-off on the Beckley House. I don't know if you all remember, but that's an affordable elderly housing complex, which we basically cannot have any of the planning and zoning regulations apply to it because of the affordability. But they did come before us. We had an approval. I went up there to do an inspection. It looks as though it matches the plan, but I asked before I sign off if you all recall, Mr. Baldwin, Lee Baldwin from the fire department, had asked that before we sign off on anything that he take a look at it too. Mm-hmm. And he has found on my desk this week a written approval from Mr. Baldwin. So that has been completed. And the as-built, they said they were getting me an as-built, a final as-built of the, here's another number.
Okay, and I'd like to interrupt Ruth at this time, seeing that we needed an alternate this evening. I should note Tim Abbott has just arrived and he is seated this evening as a voting member. Thank
My
you.
Apologies, thank you.
No problem. Sorry about the late phone call.
That's okay.
This was a Tuesday night. Normally our meetings are on the second Monday, and some of us just, including yours truly, just about forgot about it.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think we're all there. But
so that the final sign-off for the Beckley House is moving along. I'm waiting for their as-built. They had assured me that was coming. And just in case Tim missed it, I don't know if you were here the night that the fire marshal came and they wanted to be included.
Mm-hmm.
The fire chief wanted to be included in all the sign-offs, the final sign-offs too. So, and on that note, I had a call from Terry Doherty about Mountainside tonight to make sure to let me know that he had called Mr. Lee Baldwin about his concerns up there, and they were working everything out, and they're putting no parking along the driveway and things like that. So that issue, I was assured tonight, had been resolved. Did you have a question?
No, I just wanted to add one more thing to that. That was part of our condition with Beckley House. The motion was made by Dan Adam in regards to public safety, that the fire department have a critique or a walkthrough for, in case, you know, in our experience, when they lay a hull for a submarine in New London, they always bring in the crew that's going to sail the boat once it's put in place. And the crew members are all there, and they witness the building of the structure, so they have an idea, or the boat, so they have an idea how it's going. And that's what we wanted the fire department to see, especially with this being three stories, and, you know, and especially in a elderly people, and an evacuation with an elevator was Dan's biggest concerns.
And
the apparatus getting into the buildings, so.
Now, he did leave me a written note on my desk, and so signed written note, so that I can move forward with a final sign off, a zoning compliance for the building inspector to issue the final CO. They do have, I guess, a long waiting list of people that want to come there.
We should call it Dan's Law.
They go up there, what, six times a week for a burnt popcorn?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And we should note there are two Beckley houses in North Canaan. There is one on High Street that houses gentlemen that have come out of Mountainside facility. It's owned by Mountainside. And as you proceed around the corner and get into the Gear Village, there's a Beckley house there.
Oh, this is the elderly housing.
Yes, at Gear. So I just wanted to clarify
that. I was not clear on that. And then the final thing, as we were having, I've been having a discussion with a gentleman who bought a piece of property from Mr. Zinke. He had talked to me about building a single family home. The parcel had been labeled on the subdivision map, which I saw as other land, which means it hadn't been approved as a building lot. I said the method to get it approved is come in for re-subdivision, for a one-lot re-subdivision, and show us the maps. And he agreed to that this weekend. It had been going round and round. I hadn't called Judith yet because I had to make sure that he was willing to cover the costs of an outside consultant, and that being a legal consultant, and he would rather apply for a subdivision. He also talked about mining the property and a greenhouse, many, many different issues which we can address when he comes before the commission. So that's all I had for this evening.
Okay. Next order of business is old business site plan application from Borghese Building and East Main Street, and regards to Mr. Fika's, and Mr. Fika is here tonight and would like to address the commission, come up and go over what you have for us.
Okay, well, basically what I have for you is the drainage calculations.
Okay,
I think they're back on the desk. I did, or maybe they're in there.
Everything.
And the revised lighting plan that
we were discussing.
Right.
Yeah.
So the changes were made to the lighting plan to reflect no light transfer at all to the adjoining property. That was an issue at the last meeting.
And this was just received today.
I didn't even realize we were on the agenda today.
Usually when you submit an application, you're on the agenda until the 65 days expire or a decision has been rendered by the commission. this is a lot of information to...
Oh, absolutely. And
digest.
I didn't expect...
And what happened was when you submitted your application as of last month, that started the clock.
Okay. Now, we could be prepared for the next meeting. In addition, we will probably have a representative from Blood Iron Engineering here to discuss the filling of the floodplain. So perhaps this just should be postponed until that time?
Well, I'm looking at a timeframe here, and it's 65 days from the time the application is accepted by the commission.
Right.
We've already used up a good portion of that time already, and I believe we have another 29 days, and that will not put us to the next meeting, and we'll be short of that. So with that, we would ask for an extension after the 29 days from now for another 65 days from you.
Okay.
And you're the only one that can grant it. And if you can't grant us that, we would have to deny the application this evening because it would fall short of our other regular scheduled meeting. So if you were willing to extend it from the 29 days condition from...
Well, the 29 days ends when then? It's beyond the 10th, isn't it?
Well, if... I think what he's asking for is he wants a written extension tonight for the 65 days because we have quite a bit of material to...
We're just going to run out of time here, unfortunately.
And we have to coordinate with getting the fee for the consultant and getting him to review the drainage.
We did receive a letter here, and I'm sure that you have a copy also.
And he has what you have as of yesterday.
Okay. We talked about the lighting on here, Dumpton. One of the other things.
I'm sorry to interrupt. No. Did you want? I meant to hand these out.
Yes.
And I'm sorry.
Yes.
And then maybe you can read it to the.
Ruth has a copy of the letter from Rory
to the commission.
I'll read the letter to the commission from Rory E. Cavanaugh, P.E., 150 Lakeside Boulevard East, Waterbury, Connecticut, 06708, Connecticut license number 16693, dated October 1st, 2014, to the Planning and Zoning Commission regarding site plan for Mr. Fika and the North Canaan Dunkin' Donuts. Dear sirs, as requested, I'm pleased to submit a proposal to perform a site plan review of the Fika North Canaan Project Dunkin' Donuts on East Main Street, U.S. Route 44, Canaan, Connecticut. Project as submitted by Borghese Building and Engineering Incorporated. Based upon experience with previous projects similar to size and scope, the estimated fee to review the site visit and possible meeting with the commission is $950. The review should include project plans, drainage report, computations, and traffic impact study. The traffic study inquiry and analysis are particularly important due to the limited nature of the site and historic traffic loading of a facility of this nature. Thank you for the opportunity to be of service. Please feel free to contact me if you have any questions regarding this proposal. Sincerely, Rory E. Cavanaugh, P.E. It was a copy was also sent to Borghese Building and Engineering, and it's on file at the North. Under North Canaan Dunkin' Donuts in the building official's office. Yeah. Also, I have a fax here from...
I have copies in there, too, Steve, if you want them to have.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to interrupt, Mr. Chairman.
No, no problem. Thank you. We have also a fax from Mr. Cavanaugh. This was set Monday, October 13, 2014 at 9:28 p.m. And it was sent to Daddy at work. Subject, Dunkin' Donuts, North Canaan. On Monday, October 13th, p.m., Dave Batista of Leonard Engineering wrote, Roy, thank you for taking my call this afternoon to discuss the Dunkin' Donuts site in North Canaan. I am writing to summarize our conversation for your files for Joe Fika and Alan Borghese. As I explained, the proposed project will fill somewhere between 2,000 and 3,000 cubic yards in the flood fringe of the town floodplain management regulations. Require dual principles of the compensatory storage and equal conveyance. And the compensatory storage, in case where the flood fringe will be, a developer must mitigate the lost floodplain volume by excavating the equal amount of volume to the floodplain on site plan land secured at appropriate easement. The regulations state that the compensatory storage must be provided within the same hydraulic reach and volume not previously used by the flood storage. It shall be hydraulically compatible with inclementary equal to the theoretical volume of flood water at each elevation up to including the 100-year flood elevation, which would be displaced by the proposed project. Excavation of the
compensatory.
I'm going to let you read the next one after that, Ruth, and I'll finish up this one because my throat is really bothering me. In the manner consistent with the regulations appear feasible on the property located just upstream of Dunkin' Donuts site. The property owner appears to be receptive to granting an easement for the necessary excavation. As part of Mr. Fika's flood plan permit application, we propose to identify the general locations and the elevations of the from the property owner regarding his willing.
Regarding his willingness to grant an easement.
Yes. However, we propose to defer the time and the commitment developing a precise topographic map detail granted the excavation until after the floodplain development plan is granted. In other words, we would like to have the detail work considered as a condition of approval. You indicated the support for the approach and the mentioned the town could always hold off in issuing the CO until the compensatory storage issue is closed in the satisfaction of the Planning and Zoning Commission. Obviously, the Planning and Zoning, not you, will make the final decision call and question of conditional approval. However, your evasion of support and the idea with when the time comes. So, go ahead, Ruth.
Equal conveyance. The town's regulations stipulate that encroachments resulting from filling are prohibited unless the applicant provides certification from a registered professional engineer demonstrating with supporting hydrologic and hydraulic analysis performed in accordance with standard engineering practice, such as that such encroachments shall not result in any increase in flood levels, meaning the base flood elevation. Work within the floodplain and the land adjacent to the floodplain, including work to provide compensatory storage, shall not be constructed in such a way as to cause an increase in flood stage or flood velocity. I construed this language to require a hydraulic analysis to predict water surface profile elevations before and after the encroachment and compensatory storage excavations are constructed. Standard practice is to use FEMA's hydraulic model as the basis for the hydraulic analysis. In this case, I tried to order backup data of FEMA's hydraulic modeling of the Blackberry River. I ordered the data through the normal channels. FEMA could not locate the model in their archives, despite the fact that the analysis is only 6 years old. I contacted the agency responsible for preparing the Blackberry River hydraulic model in 2008, which was the USGS, to see if I could locate either a hard copy or digital files containing the model. I've not heard back from them, and I'm not very certain that my search will yield success. I'm reasonably confident that there will be no impact, but I cannot prove it. You and I agree that there is really no way to tell whether the small encroachment will increase water surface elevations on the very flat Blackberry River floodplain without some form of hydraulic analysis. In the absence of acquiring the FEMA model, creation of a new hydraulic model will be required. A reasonably precise model like the one prepared by FEMA would involve surveyed cross-sections and comprehensive engineering work that would come at a great expense. Alternately, we could develop a simplified model prepared using estimated channel and floodplain geometry. The simplified model could be employed as a screening tool to gauge sensitivity of the floodplain to the proposed encroachment. If I construed your reaction properly, you indicated some sympathy regarding our inability to acquire FEMA data, and you expressed a willingness to consider it a simplified analysis, but it's too early for you to make any commitments at this point. You have not yet been hired, and the issue deserves a good deal of thought. Accordingly, our conversation left this issue without resolution. You asked me to convey, this is other site plan issues, your preliminary thoughts to the developer regarding the site plan. Number one, you're not certain whether a full-blown traffic impact study is warranted, but Dunkin' Donuts stores are typically viewed as substantial traffic generators. There is a limited storage available on-site and little, if any, on Route 44. It may behoove the developer to put some effort into a traffic analysis to help convince you and the commission that the proposed impacts are properly mitigated. Number two, the site plan should show proposed lighting and associated photometrics. Number three, dumpster screening is always an issue. Number four, the regulations require a host of items to be shown on the site plan. The sewer connection, as one example, should be shown on the site plans. The developer's site planner should go through the regulations to make sure that the required items are addressed. You intend to go right down through the list in checklist fashion during peer review. Thank you for your time today. I greatly appreciate your willingness to speak with me on the project for which you have not yet been hired to work on. I look forward to working with you, the applicant, and the PZC toward approval of this project. My only comment is that this commission has hired him, and if this, and this estimate for $950, if that's not paid, the application is not complete either.
Okay.
So we need to get that on the record too. That.
Okay, just so that we're clear, though, you were hiring them. I'm reimbursing you.
Right.
Yes.
So this letter was saying that he's not yet hired, but he is hired, and as soon as we get the $950, you can go ahead and make some statements.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I have a couple of questions.
Yes.
One related to what was just read, one related to whether the request for a 65-day extension had been concluded.
It hasn't been concluded. The request has been made.
Okay.
It must be received in writing from the applicant.
You can do that right now.
Yeah, starting to.
Can do that.
We're going to go the 29 days,
yep.
And then we're going to add 65 mm-hmm. on the end of that. And that would give us a lot more time to digest this information that, you know, we have the drainage calculations, which just came into the town hall today.
Okay, so that answers that question for me.
The
applicant has the ability to, and is the only one who has the ability to request that.
Yes.
To grant the extension.
Okay. Without granting the extension, we denied the application.
Okay. Prior to that, I have one question about what was just read to us in the second one, which was, I think that FEMA data exists at my agency.
It does.
I'm fairly confident that HVA has the Blackberry River floodplain stuff from 6 years ago. And I'm happy to look into that, and if there's a need to direct the town's reviewer to that data, probably can confirm that.
That would be great.
No, the applicant could.
To the applicant.
That's
Tim Abbott.
Mm-hmm.
It's the
Houston Valley Association, who I work for, and I'm fairly confident we've got that.
They're in Cornwall, Connecticut.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, the name of the
Houston Valley Association? It's in Cornwall.
And his name is Tim Abbott. Uh-huh. I can give you all that information in the office.
Thank
you. If you want. Uh-huh.
That's all I have.
I'm looking for the train to go by.
Back on track. That's it for me.
Okay, thanks, Dan. Ruth, after last month's meeting, I don't know whether the rest of the commission members had a chance to see it, but we do have a floodplain map right in the lobby. Mm-hmm. Maybe the commission at this time could walk out and take a look at that and then familiarize themselves with the area in question to give you a heads up on it. Mm-hmm. Also, I during our conversation, Karen Riccadelli, an adjacent property owner, came in. And so we'll allow her to speak under public comment, too. But at this time, if we could go out and you could explain to us on the map, and everybody will have a full understanding. It's just right out here in the lobby. Hi, Karen.
Is that something I can look at?
Yeah, it's public. It's been accepted.
So we're going to chat and refer that on to the...
So what this is showing are wetland soils, alluvial and the ones that are poorly drained, most of which are regulated in Connecticut. It doesn't seem to be showing the FEMA 100-year floodplain for the Blackberry.
Here we go.
Yeah, but that's not the same thing.
No.
So can we find the property here? It's one of these in here, right?
Yes, this is the chop and chop right here.
Yeah.
These are...
One of them.
Yeah, see this property?
Yeah.
The pink goes almost to 44. That's the property where they have the drainage coming from the Department of Transportation across the street, correct?
So, yeah, the FEMA data is going to be more fine scale.
Right.
But that's the general.
But I just wanted you guys to be aware of, you know, what this map was and how it will, and there's information on here that they can be drawn from for this application, too, in regards to basically this section here that's all pink. And I refer to this as being Foley's Field here, mm-hmm. and that's your adjacent property owner.
So that's up to date?
Yes.
Taking into consideration.
The soil data is up to date.
The soil data is. Okay. And basically, they're just showing us that basically the floodplain sales is what's on there. And then you take this information, what you looked at here, then you go into the office, look at the floodplain maps that were provided to us by FEMA.
And what FEMA's done is has modeled how a 100-year flood under current projections impacts these more hydric soils.
Yeah.
So that's what we'll look at.
Mm-hmm.
Great.
All right, we can go back to the room. I just figured that we'd have a clear understanding.
What is watershed mean? That's where the watershed went up?
Yes.
So do you see any as you go and we have this little bit, like this little empty pool?
We're going to let you speak during public hearing.
Public comment.
I'm sorry, not public hearing. So we're all back in after doing the map.
Dan's going to...
Yep. So what do you need to do with Ruth the fee on this, seeing that we place this in the zoning enforcement officer's hand?
Well, the consultant has asked for $950. We usually, he can pay either one. You can make the check out directly to Roy E. Kavanaugh for the consulting fee. If we put it through the town, it's just another layer, and we'll have to wait to see how that goes.
And when would that be paid?
That we could ask the...
It can be paid anytime.
Okay, great.
I just spoke with Roy yesterday, so...
Okay.
We see that, yeah. He informed me of that tonight, that you had made contact. And,
yes.
And so if we take care of that, he can move forward, do his review. You said you had sent him that because this was the first time I had seen this information. So
yes.
I had told him that a drainage report was coming.
I delivered it to his house yesterday.
Great.
That's the same thing
you
have right now. I'm just going to hang out.
So then he could be ready.
He also has the traffic report from
Heskis.
Norm Tatzbaugh could not make it tonight, but he did make a comment that he thought maybe they could find a better location in regards to not having to do so much alteration, considering the property is almost like a horseshoe, including the proposed Dunkin' Donuts, the Lego floor covering, and the Riccadelli accounting. He had indicated his concerns were that the two buildings built, which would be to the western side of the proposed Dunkin' Donuts, don't have adequate foundation structure to, if they decided to fill their property to get themselves out of the floodplain, that's something that would have to be determined by a building engineer, what could happen there. And he indicated that he was concerned about the parking spaces, and unfortunately he could not be here tonight. He's got a low-grade fever due to other health complications, so.
Mr. Chairman, I have another
yes.
question. On the queuing, that was one concern that both the engineer and I both had. I don't see on your queuing. What do you expect to be your queuing on? It shows on this about 5 cars. Is that?
You mean for the drive-thru?
Mm-hmm.
It's a 14 car staff.
So you have 14 cars.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And you feel that that's adequate queuing for?
That's
the
DOT
standard.
I think I mentioned this last month too. One of my other concerns was with the drive-through, you have a number of cars. You look at, just take 3 cars here and stack them out to Route 44, indicating that if this car wants to turn left onto Route 44, it's very indicative of the traffic in North Canaan to be backed up completely to the, I refer to as the west side stop and shop exit and the gas stations in the morning. You know, I think that would create a traffic congestion, and I had recommended that the cars be only allowed to make a right-hand turn going out of there instead of trying to cross a lane of traffic and get into traffic and possibly causing more of a congestion or possibly a motor vehicle accident if it could involve someone's well-being.
You have a traffic engineer, Mr. Heskett, a traffic study.
He did.
And you have a copy of that somewhere. Okay. Did you send that to Roy also?
That was going to be emailed to him last night, so he should have it by now.
Because he'll leave through Stop and Shop.
We should probably get a copy of that to see what he said about that right hand turn only.
Yeah.
Did he make any recommendations like that?
I thought this was the first step of this approval was a DOT approval, and then once they approve it, then we're going to move forward on.
Okay.
Who's reviewing it at DOT? Do you know?
I don't know. I'd have to ask Scott.
I just noticed that.
Is it Tim Lamb or Tom Murphy? One of the other no names. Okay, because that's another piece of information that would be good to know. You said Scott. Now I'm sorry to say.
Scott Heskett.
Oh, okay. So he's applied to,
yes, to
Connecticut
DOT.
DOT.
Yes.
Basically, this land was the lowest part of the Christensen property, and they sold it off. And to me, myself, I don't know why, you know, with a watershed like this, you know, why they would even, you know, consider, I don't even know how it wound up being approved. Because it's like the drainage for that main property that was here, you know, coming off in this direction here.
Was this, how old is the lot? When was the lot cut off?
That was cut off in 2006, 2005.
I didn't buy it from the Christiansons. I bought it from the carpet shop, previous carpet shop owner.
Oh, so it belonged to Tyler. So that was the lowest part of his property.
Right.
Wow.
And he did it with the first cut?
Yes.
That's the only way.
Because it's probably in a...
Actually, it was two lots, to be honest with you.
Oh, it was?
It was two lots. It wasn't...
It was existing...
It was an existing lot.
Pre-existing non-conformity at the time, because zoning came in afterwards.
Well, subdivision regulations started in 1971, so if it was...
If it was...
If it hadn't been divided since 1971, he was entitled to a free cut.
Yep.
That might have been...
So it was the Tyler Company. All right. There's a lot there. See, my biggest concern, too, is like, as Norm had pointed out to me, he says this is like a horseshoe here. I currently know that when we had that big flood here in Canaan, that they sandbagged the Black Forest Cafe in the back. I think Completed Homes had it at the time to keep the water from going into there. I believe both Tyler's and Mrs. Riccadelli's, the previous owner, both of those basements received considerable amount of water in there. And my concern is if we fill this in and we have this watershed pushing off, you see how close it is to Mr. Lagle's building, how much of a, you know, the slope goes down, you know, to a pretty good extreme there.
So this is why the FEMA stuff is going to be important.
Yeah, we really need it.
We're going to need to see as much good quality data as we can on what that 100-year flood.
The lot is relatively flat, the exception of coming off 44.
Yeah, there's down steep, below steep it's flat. Completely flat, yeah.
Yeah, it's all.
And then you have the large drain for the Department of Transportation relatively.
And that's where all this talk of the compensatory storage comes in.
Yes, yeah, and I see
and
that
you... What we're striving for is a net, a net zero increase or decrease in storage.
Okay. Yeah, I just, you know, so close to his existing building, I don't even... You know, with that, the way the property goes down like that, and then if he elevates here and the building is going down, it's built on a slope, you know, it doesn't look like there's a lot of footage there.
So I keep thinking about, was it two meetings ago when we had the conversation on low impact development and ways in which impervious surface can be reduced in parking areas. Sean Hayden came up from Northwest Conservation District and gave us about an hour walkthrough on that, and actually went and looked at the parking area he was talking about in Torrington afterwards, and it's pretty neat. It would be nice to see if consideration could be made when thinking about not just retention, but just the amount of impervious surface flow, whether some of those techniques might be part of the solution.
Impervious surface and to a drain, extensive drainage system underneath the surface to allow the water to be directed.
You need both, right? You need something that allows water to infiltrate, not just move off in a sheet.
Right.
And that directs it where it needs to go.
Yeah.
I thought the drainage plan showed the storage and the way that the design was to bleed the water off slowly and in a fanned off area in the back. I guess they call it a spreader. I'm not that familiar with the terminology, but the detailed plans show that. I don't know if you can make any of that out on what you're looking at right there, but you have detailed plans in your
Right here we do have the I'll call them galleys. Would that be correct in calling them galleys here in the back side of the building by the drive through?
You said you had a level spreader somewhere?
There's a spreader in the back.
Yeah, see that right there, that's for the DOT, and then there's another one right here for these galleys here. It's a very short spreader, not anything like the DOT.
I'm sorry, what are you referring to?
Is this what is referred?
No.
We're going to spread it to here, this is the pipe from across the street.
Okay.
Okay, and it discharges right here presently. What we're going to do is increase the size of the pipe, ran across the property, and it's going to discharge into a level spreader here. Okay, so you have a larger or fanned out discharge. As far as any of the water, stormwater that this site creates, it will then be first stored in galleys and then discharged the same way. I'm not an engineer or a civil engineer, but.
Yeah, I think we should just refer these plans and then.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah,
let them go from there.
And then move forward, yeah.
What I'm just trying to do is get the commission to get an understanding of this.
Sure.
You know, so when we do sit down, I have a lot of confidence in Dan and Pete and Tim to be able to decipher a lot of the information. I've seen it all before and.
It'd be nice to hear what the engineer has to say if he comes to a meeting and can explain all this.
Yeah, so the way we would do that is we need Mr. Diva to give a written request or.
A granting
to the commission a 65-day extension from what. We forget this out.
Well, just the sentence, it's just a 65-day extension.
65-day extension.
That's all he has to write.
And that would allow us to then meet in November and if necessary, December.
Yes, yeah. And we will have the engineer here. Mr. Fika will have his people from Borghese here, you know.
And from Lennard Engineering, if necessary.
Yeah.
In a future time, we can have Scott Heskey here as well.
Great.
Sounds great.
So before we move forward, we'd like to get that in writing from you.
Okay, I can do that. Do you want to move on to something else and I'll write something up? Or do you want to just, or if you like to write something so that it's clearer to you than me.
I'll put it and then you can sign it.
Perfect.
Okay. You can have a seat right here, Joe.
Also unresolved from my bookkeeping standpoint is I don't think I paid for the original application because there was some issue.
Because of the floodplain, we were looking up what the floodplain, there's a floodplain application.
Which hasn't even been filed yet, but we needed a, which will be filed by the next time we see us.
We'll straighten that out in the office. I thought I was going to talk to you on a Saturday, and I didn't hear from anybody, so we'll straighten that out. I'm not going to be here this year, but I have been the last week.
What's it, 25?
I just don't want it to be a stipulation, so.
Did you know it's a 25% per day?
Oh.
Is that right? Maybe 50.
There you go. Good. Good for the record while you're at it, that's a good idea.
And that check will be made out to the.
You personally?
No, the commission, you know, for our new equipment upgrade. We should, that's something I wanted to talk to the commission too, is tonight about upgrading our technology. I spoke to Kathy McCare, who was here filming for Mr. Miles, if we could get copies from here on in and then submit them as part of our record. And that way, it's always.
Could I possibly get some contact information from you?
Sure. Yeah.
And this way, what I'll do, I think just have Dave Batista from Lennard call you directly.
Fine.
Thank you. so we need to hear the...
The stuff might exist.
Yes.
I think it does. I'm fairly confident, in fact, that we got it.
No, he's gonna sell it. I'm just writing it.
Okay.
He was telling me what was involved in plotting that out.
I can't believe somebody wants that.
Sign it, and then it'll go into new business, which will be public comment.
I'm gonna sign that, and then I'll take it.
Better read it first.
Yeah. It's not my life over now. All right, thank you.
Is that all you need?
Yes, and then if you want to give even, you can send the check directly to Mr. Kavanaugh.
If that's easier for you, I'd be happy to do that.
Yes, that makes it easier for the town, it's just a...
And then you'll be back here on the November 8th, 6th?
The second Monday would be the 10th.
November 10th.
The 8th is a Saturday, when's the 10th? Oh, is the 10th Veterans Day?
Yeah, so it'll be the next day.
So it'll be Tuesday.
Tuesday will be 11th.
Landing, and it says, oh, the next day is Veterans Day.
That's right.
So what's wrong with Monday?
Oh, there's nothing wrong with Monday, right?
Ooh, the holiday is on Tuesday. It says on here.
Cheryl's got a mark planning and zoning, so the meeting is, the town hall will be open on the 10th.
Okay.
And then from Veterans Day is Tuesday, the 11th will be closed, so...
So we're good?
Yeah.
So it will be Monday then?
Yes, Monday the 10th. We have our regular scheduled meetings posted in the lobby.
Okay.
So if you want to go down the end of the hall before leaving, but I would suggest that you probably wait. We're moving to new business, public comment. Yeah, your neighbor's here to speak and maybe get some information.
Sure, and in the meantime, Ruth, if you need anything else from Alan, in the meantime, please feel free to give him a call.
Okay, great.
Most of your correspondence will be through...
Yeah, I'm gonna let Roy, you know, Roy take care of Alan.
Roy incidentally has permission to speak with Scott Hesketh, David Batista, and Alan, so...
Okay, great, thank you.
So now that we have, I'll read this in for the record, a 65-day extension. I, Joseph Fika, grant a 65-day extension to the north, to the town of North Canaan Planning and Zoning Commission for the site approval for the proposed Dunkin' Donuts on East Main Street. Sincerely, Joseph Fika. Okay, thank you. Next order of business will be new business public comment. Karen?
Okay. Well, I'm an avid coffee drinker, so I like Dunkin' Donuts. My only concern is when it rains now really hard, I know the parking lot behind Legos does flood. They tend to use my side because there is horrific water issues in the back, more so on their side, because the lot kind of, if you look from my building, you know, it kind of goes like that.
Yeah.
There's a corner that's really bad. Very wet, which is where you guys want to maybe dump your water.
Just so I understand, your property, what you're talking about is...
I'm right here.
Okay.
So Legal and I...
Just on the other side of Legal.
Yeah, we share the parking lot.
Okay.
So my side, I had the sod removed, had Phil brought in. I'm higher. My side is higher than his. The lot kind of, when you look from the road down, the lot kind of goes like that a little bit, just the way it is, you know? And, but his side is extremely wet. Just one heavy downpour, and it's very wet, you know? So my only concern is that if more water comes off, it would be very harmful to our businesses. I know Legos does use his basement.
So yours doesn't get as wet as his because you added fill?
I don't know. I just think that's just the way the land is. Because if anything, I took sod out and then they brought in, so maybe it was an even exchange of dirt. But
I recall because I was at Legos picking up my carpet and I was kind of swearing because I couldn't turn around.
Oh, in the mud. Yeah, it was bad. It was always been very wet and soupy back there.
But
so
I actually looked at her building as a possible perspective. It was on the market, so it was for sale, so I figured I'd take a look at it. Who knows, you know?
Sure.
It's commercial space in Canaan, and downtown there's no parking, but this place seemed to have parking, so I got thinking about it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of like how I know so much about the area, because when you go to look at it, you get a good idea. And I noticed too, there was a lot of arborvitaes, a wetland species, all in that one corner down in back of Lagel's and partially onto your property. Mm-hmm. So it's showing that there's the retention of quite a bit of water there.
Yeah, there's a lot of water.
Yeah.
So that I would be really concerned about what you would do to make sure, to guarantee that it wouldn't come onto our property. We have a bookkeeping business also. So in the basement we have lockers for our clients. They put their data and their computers in there. I wouldn't want it getting flooded.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it'd be very concerning to me if. Isn't there a way you could ensure that the water wouldn't come onto our land? Because it would be a nice business flow to have the Dunkin' Donuts. I would just be very concerned about the water. Mm-hmm. But there must be something you can do to ensure that our parking lots don't get flooded. Mm-hmm. Or that we just control the water.
I suppose ideally, if everyone filled their backyard and did it the same way we're engineering ours, then everyone would have the same solution we're going to have.
But the only problem is when you really look at it from the commission's standpoint, you have hypothetically three separate parcels, and if you allow one to fill and this one doesn't have the capital to do it, or this one doesn't have the capital to do it, you're creating a hardship for the other two.
Yes, and ideally, this site needs, I'm not sure if I'm speaking out of turn.
No, that's what it's comment. Public comment.
Okay. Ideally, this, I'm told that we're attempting to engineer this in a way where it doesn't impact anything.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the way we're doing this compensatory water storage, where we're adding material, we're taking it out somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
So that there should be, in theory, a net, it should be net even.
It should be zero.
It should be zero, even if we needed to go a little bit beyond that and make it a negative impact.
Mm-hmm.
As long as Foley is okay with that, we could do that too.
Yeah.
So if we needed to go a little bit beyond, whereby we took additional material out that I couldn't use, but we stacked it on a high spot of his property, isn't that, in fact, increasing storage? So I think the engineers are prepared to make an argument that this is possible.
This is possible, right.
Mm-hmm.
And Karen has duly noted, too, that your concerns are possible damage to your property.
Right. Well, the other thing is, whereas I could maybe fill in the back of my lot, Lagel can't, because he has delivery trucks coming in the back.
Mm-hmm.
It's not so simple for him.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it's an issue for him, he's not here, but I just see the business going on. He actually uses the back of his building.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I could do stairs down into mine, not a big deal, it's foot mm-hmm. traffic, but he has truck delivery materials moving in and out.
He's indicated to me that he's using that building less and less for storage and actually working out of it. He has another building further up on 7
right.
where he actually stores the carpet and works out of.
Mm-hmm.
This is becoming more of a showroom for him than an actual working building. But
yeah, like I say, zero impact is the best way to go.
Right.
Absolutely.
I can't believe an engineer would not take that into account. I'm assuming, but it's good to know that.
Well, I think
you're concerned.
It's just if you come on a heavy rainfall day, you'll see it. You'll see the water.
I'm sure.
Yeah, it almost fills in almost half of his mm-hmm. spot. I mean, I'm just. I guess because I have a bank. The bank was kind of collapsing into my parking area. Anyway, they just kind of.
We
took the side out and graveled it or whatever.
We could actually debate and go back and forth with this all night long. I'm sure we could. Usually in a situation like this, the best thing to do is to set a public hearing.
Mm-hmm.
And that would allow the neighbors to come in and speak about it at a public hearing and voice their concerns there and put it pretty much on record and work with the applicant or wherever. And then that gives the commission, you know, we can ask.
Also, though, if the public was here while the engineer was here, perhaps they would, you know, some of their, you know, questions would be.
Right, they would get asked questions, that's good.
Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to point out that in that letter, the email that we read, they talked about equal conveyance, and that was the whole gist of the, that shall not result in any or zero increase in flood levels, and that is the reason that we needed to have a town engineer on our, to look at, to make sure that this is happening and reassure the public. And I think that with everyone here at the next meeting, that gives everyone a chance and the neighbors a chance.
If the commission decided to set a public hearing, it would be up to the commission to do so. We could have.
Prior to the regular meeting, as we normally do.
Yeah.
Is November enough time to organize it?
Don't you think, I mean, if you have this information available to our consulting engineer, I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, I was just interrupting.
Fine. Thank you.
If we have this information, I believe that we could have it ready, have all the people here, I mean, if.
For the next meeting or before, sure.
For the next meeting.
Which would be the 10th of November.
And we should confirm that 10th, if you call the.
Building official office.
Yeah, Cheryl will be in, and she can confirm it. Just ask her about Veterans Day so we don't make a mistake. We have made one in the.
Okay, but the request for a public hearing would be
up to the commission.
Right, they would vote on to set it for their next regular meeting, and then we can confirm.
They'd just be done back to back.
Gotcha.
We have to see if this Roy Kavanaugh is available for. Or is there going to be a different proposal?
You could vote tonight to set a public hearing for the next regular meeting conditioned on whether or not the consulting engineer would be available.
And not only that, if we have the additional 65 days, if it went into December, we have always made a decision. We have probably about 90% voting after we closed the public hearing. We moved into our regular meeting and voted on the application. So if it didn't work out in November, it definitely could work out in December.
So, Mr. Chairman, I'd make the motion that we set a public hearing condition on whether our consulting engineer is able to attend us prior to and on the same day of our next scheduled PNZ meeting.
And that would be November
10th? That's November 10th.
At 7 o'clock, and then regular meeting to follow.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. I'll second that if you want.
The motion has been made by Tim Abbott and seconded by Pete Brown. Is there any discussion? Seeing there is none, those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, so moved. We get a lot done.
Okay.
So, thank you for coming out tonight.
And thank you for your time.
Yeah.
Am I done here? Or?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
There's a Dunkin' Donuts up the street. For a while.
Yeah.
Okay.
Control over
Basically, the engineering studies will all be done by the engineer of the site.
Is it expensive?
I'm trying to think of Mr. Borghese. That would be up to them, the PEs, to decide.
That's
what
a question
material.
That you could
you
ask.
You see a lot of places that fill in, it's big chunks of concrete.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, no.
You could ask that, and then you could ask what kind of though, and that could be conditioned.
You could say, I want three-quarter-inch processed gravel, or you could say, I want quarry chips, I want air.
But I can comment.
As long as you have the opportunity, so
I
don't think we should be doing making a landfill.
What we refer to as clean fill in regard to something that's compactable.
I think it should be slag.
That would make a very good.
They can't do a worm or something.
I have a place in mind where I can get it.
Well, Sam, we're throwing bits here. Can you get anything on your plane?
It must be something that's
any gravel?
I got some rebar, but we just rolled it out.
All right. We'll move into formal discussion. Just for the Housatonic River Commission, Christian had indicated that they would like to come back on his Christmas break during December. And possibly, we should have our regulations all in order at that point. Just basically, we're going to, from what I understood, Cornwall has pretty much drafted it. And if each community who gets involved, which we are involved, but accepts it, should all be the same as the river flows.
Right.
You know, for the same wording, it's just instead of saying X town, it will be the town of North Canaan.
Sure.
So,
Ruth and I... for it to be consistent.
Yeah, Ruth and I will try to get together and...
Spruce that up
and go from there. But other than that...
For our Christmas hats.
Yeah.
Work on it.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, there's another deadline coming up on us. I can't remember how many months it's been, but we're probably pretty close to six since we did our six-month moratorium on medical marijuana dispensaries.
I think at this time that we should extend it because the state still hasn't set much of a regulation to the zoning commissions.
Right.
And how to administer the law. I know that there's been some work done on it, but I haven't heard anything. I haven't received, usually Steve Byrne keeps us apprised of any changes that is happening with the legislative body in the state or the, the medical community and how they're going to be doing this. But
so I made the previous motion to have a six-month moratorium while we gathered information and considered what we wanted our zoning regulations to say. I'd be happy to make a motion to extend another 6 months or until such time as we get better guidance. But I think we should, in the intervening 6 months, see what's out there. Because if there's some work we can do.
Could you refresh me on what date we did approve that? What month?
I cannot remember, but it was months and months ago.
Okay, would you like to make a motion?
I would like to make a motion. We extend it another 6 months.
Okay.
On the moratorium on
medical marijuana.
Considering basically it's the dispensaries for medical marijuana. There's only four approved producers of it, and only one of them is operational right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's the one in Watertown, I think.
Yes, it is.
But there's no way to legally purchase it.
Right.
Here.
I think they've issued a couple of these dispensaries now.
Mm-hmm.
And just to update you, another community has defined in their, they've taken the approach of just putting into their definitions
mm-hmm.
that a dispensary is not considered a retail use.
Mm-hmm.
And that way, and if you don't have what it is, then it basically, and it's not on your use table as in certain zones, it basically is saying you don't have it.
Got it.
Because if it's not defined as a retail use, right now, it's a, without doing that, it's a retail use and can go anywhere in your retail area.
That is.
So that's a potential interim step we could take.
So you
say it's not defined as a retail use.
Right.
Yes, and I could bring you that language and we could
put it in our table of uses.
Well, I think you would I don't think you have a definition of, you don't have very many definitions. You could say retail, make a common definition of retail, and then at the end of the definition say that this is not considered a retail use.
Yeah. So, all right.
In the
then
town
I,
of
then
Canaan,
maybe
so.
my motion has two parts. Then the first part is that we do another 6 month extension of our moratorium, and the second is that we consider Ruth's language at our next meeting.
Yes. Okay, that sounds fine.
Okay.
Do we have a second on that?
I'll second that.
Okay, Dan Adams second. Tim Abbott has made the motion. Any more discussion on that? Seeing none. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, so moved. Any other business before this commission? Okay, seeing we have none, I make a motion to close the meeting at 8:04. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
So moved.
He's gonna wake up the camera.